perspectives on that. He'll talk for 10 or 15 minutes and then take questions. So please, he can stay for about an hour. So please have your questions ready for him. Ralph Nader.
Thank you. This is pretty nice use of public space. Why should we just have ancient generals, you know, sitting on horses? The commons is something that's part of this movement, that the people own the greatest wealth in the country, the Commonwealth. Just think of it, all the public lands, one-third of America, the public airwaves, all the trillions of dollars of government research and development that built the internet industry and the aerospace industry and the good deal of the pharmaceutical industry out of NIH and the containerization industry and the biotech industry. You know, they make it like they did it themselves, but without the taxpayers feeding the research and development, you wouldn't even recognize these industries. Now, so there are a lot of commons, and there's a whole movement actually just devoted to educating young people about the commons and what we own. Not what we should own, what we already own as a commonwealth, which we do not control. So we own all this minerals onshore and offshore on public lands, but we don't control it. Our government, in effect, for bargain basement prices, or in the terms of hard rock minerals, gives it away. See, did you know that Canadian company discovered $9 billion worth of gold on our land in Nevada, public land, federal land, and got it for $30,000. Because under the 1872 Act, all they got to do is pay $5 an acre. So they got $9 billion with a B and no royalties back to the government. So when you're here, you're on the commons. Don't let anybody tell you, you know, you're here at the sufferance and all that. This is your territory. And there's plenty of it around the country.
Yeah.
Imagine if we had a political campaign where one of the issues was controlling what we own. Because we don't control the resources on our public lands. We don't control the public airways. Why shouldn't we have our own networks, our own radio and TV station? We're the landlords. The TV and radio stations are the tenants. And they don't pay us any rent. And they decide who says what, who doesn't, 24 hours a day on all these radio and TV stations using our property. So you see, once people get aroused on that, a lot of things happen. So most movements start from a sense of injustice, because if you don't have a sense of injustice, you can't have a sense of justice. Think about that. That's almost axiomatic. But their legs have got to be based in fact. There's got to be a lot of facts. Otherwise, you'll end up in a collision of ideologies with a lot of abstractions, regulation, over-regulation, tax, not tax, you know, defense, offense, military, peace. But when you get grounded in the facts, that's what really gives a movement its motive power, in addition to the principles of right and wrong. And these corporations, these large corporations, are violating almost every standard you can imagine. They violate the laws that they even write. They can't even abide by a lot of the pollution laws or the fiduciary statutes that they help write in Congress. They violate the most basic standards of ethics of any civilization, of fairness, caring, disclosure, notice, honesty. They violate the golden rule. Right and left. I mean, you pick your standard. If you're religious, if you're just a secular ethicist, if you're a stickler on the law and regulation, they violated it. And as a result, that's why they're the 1%. That's why they're the minority, tiny, tiny minority. And that kind of motive force really has a lot of engine power behind it. If the fuel is based in facts, in reality. So that's what we got. Now, just to give you an illustration, today on the radio, there is a study that talked about the poor. There's now a new category. It's called the poor. And there's 20 million people in this country in the category of the poor, poor. Now, I'll leave it to your imagination what kind of life that is. Okay, the poor, poor. Now, what part of the United States do you think has the highest percentage of its population in the category of the poor, poor?
D.C.
The District of Columbia. This is the nation's capital, run by a congressional dictatorship that can change budgets, override referendums, override statutes, ordinances, and they've done it. And so we have the highest percentage of the poor, poor in a region, Virginia suburbs, Maryland suburbs, D.C., that has the highest average income in the United States. So it's also the biggest gap in terms of wealth inequality. Now, you think there's partly a connection between that fact and the fact that the District of Columbia people do not have congressional representatives who have votes? They don't have two senators, they don't have a representative the way Delaware does, or heavily populated Wyoming. And so they have no voice. Now, year after year, we know this, year after year there are about 1,000 people who really care about this, enough to march and demonstrate and file lawsuits. And after a while, you know, people around the country look at people in the district and say, do they really want to vote? Do they really need to vote? Do they care enough to push to get the vote? And you know, that's a very fundamental question. And it's not just restricted to people in D.C. It applies to people all over the country. There half of them don't even bother voting. And the other half may vote, but they're stuck in a two-party dictatorship where their choice is a little bit broader than Pepsi and Coca-Cola. And it isn't just voting. It's voting with a sharp edge of what the voters want. It's voting based on homework by the voters, so they don't get twisted up and down by these 30-second nonsense emotional television ads by the politicians. So there is a connection, obviously, and we should recognize that here in the district, with this Occupy movement, a lot of people come here. 21 million tourists come to the district a year, and it's a great opportunity to educate people about this and make them think when they go back home, not just about the district being a colony, but actually, what about their vote? Do they have enough choices on the ballot? 90% of all congressional districts are either slam dunk Republican or slam dunk Democrat. They gerrymander them. And so there isn't even a two-party choice. Isn't it? You think Eric Cantor has to worry about his district in Virginia? I mean, he's one of the coolest guys who ever crawled up, or shall I say, slithered up Capitol Hill. And he still doesn't have to. Here's the guys after the hurricane. He said, no, we don't want to rush a bundle of money to help the hurricane victims until we set it off with some other tax decreases. He backed down after that. I mean, obviously he'd lost control of himself. Now, let's talk about the Occupy movement. Yeah. I asked myself the other day, it's in hundreds of communities, down to Niles, Michigan, 12,000 people. They have an Occupy movement. So it starts out decentralized. That's asset number one. Asset number two is that it has no specific program. Why should it? Why should it get down into the details where they have all kinds of fights over whether it should be 5%, 6%, 10%, whether this should be covered or not? Keep it at the level of general injustice with descriptions like full Medicare for all with free choice of doctor and hospital, cracking down on corporate crime, fraud, and abuse, getting out of those criminal wars of aggression by Bush and Obama, and bring the soldiers back home. Making sure we have a tax system that taxes first that which society likes the least or dislikes the most before it taxes labor. For example, it should tax Wall Street speculation. It should tax pollution, carbon tax. It should tax gambling. It should tax things that we like the least or dislike the most before we put a tax on what people like, which is work. So they can keep it at that level without getting down too specific. And at that level, it's got a lot of motive power. The other thing that needs to be done without getting too specific is to make comparisons with other countries. For example, Harvard Medical School researchers in December 2009, Journal of Public Health, listen to this one. They say that 800 Americans a week die because they can't afford health insurance to get diagnosed or treated. Now, I'm going to pause. So let that sink in. That's every week. 4 weeks more than the casualties from 9/11. Every 4 weeks. That's 45,000 Americans a year. Now, nobody dies in France, Luxembourg, Italy, Sweden, Canada, Japan, Taiwan, Norway, England, because they don't have health insurance. Nobody dies in those countries. They're insured from the minute they're born. Okay? Now, this ought to get our indignation level up. See, there's nothing more powerful than controlled indignation rooted in facts, morality, ethics. Nothing can surpass that kind of combination. When Rosa Parks refused to go to the rear of the bus in 1955, Montgomery, Alabama, a lot of people like Rosa Parks knew that black people had to go to the rear of the bus. What was different about her and her predecessor, a 16-year-old girl who didn't even get any credit? They had fire in their belly. They had what the psychologists now call emotional intelligence, if you'd like a delicate phrase. And the American people know who rules them. They know who runs them. They have to take it every day. They go to Walmart and they get $8 an hour or $9 an hour. They know the boss is making $11,000 an hour, every hour. When they can't get health care, they know why. It's Aetna, it's Cigna, it's United Healthcare. When they get their pensions looted and drained, they know why. It's Wall Street, messing around and speculating, gambling with their hard-earned money. What's missing is the sense that they can do something about it. And that sense comes from this phrase, enough is enough, which reflects fire in the belly. Yeah. That's what it is. Now just think, you're all over the country, you're in hundreds of communities and more every day, and my guess is not more than 200,000 people have participated in this effort. 200,000 people. There are millions of people ready to participate. Millions of people. There are 24 million people in this country who don't have a job or only a part-time job, and they're trying to find work if you want a pool to draw on. So if only 200,000 people have pulled this off, what does that tell you? It tells you that maybe there's a lot of truth to the phrase 99%, that they're reflecting the public sentiment, to use one of Abraham Lincoln's words, the public sentiment of a vast majority of the people in this country. Now, the other thing we have to get rid of is exaggerating the power of our opponents. These corporations and these government agencies, they are collaborating against the interests of the average person in this country, because we grow up being told we're powerless in a thousand ways, starting in the first grade. We grow up being told you can't fight City Hall, it doesn't matter, whatever it will be, just, you know, sort of get a job, have a few hobbies, raise some kids, shut up and keep shopping. That's the message. And what we've got to do is deconstruct how powerful they really are. Now, down here, there's a Congress. It's the most powerful branch of government. Far more powerful under the Constitution than the White House and the courts. It has the taxing power, the spending power, the war declaration power, the investigatory power, and on. Now, what is the Congress? Well, you can say it's a puppet of Wall Street. You can say it sold itself to the highest bidders. You can say that it's full of cowards. You can say that it has people who can barely think in popular terms. But you know what it really is? It's 535 men and women who put their shoes on every day like you and I. 1,500 corporations get their way with most of those 535 people. They don't have a single vote. Where's the vote? It's back home, unorganized. So once you realize that the only thing they really care about is not campaign money. Campaign money is designed to get them votes. All they care about is votes. All they care about is competition by other candidates who might get votes. So imagine if this Occupy movement begins first to have one day where all over the country they encircle the office of each senator and representative back home. Big cordon. This is the way they're going to do in the White House on the gas pipeline.
Yeah.
Big cordon, right? All at once. The first thing that happens is that there's a run in Congress on underarm deodorants. Okay? Congress is a bubble now. They haven't felt what the Occupy movement has done. It's not been directed toward them. They haven't even changed anything. They're still talking the same old. They've still got these fundraising parties by these vendors that are buying them and renting them. So now it's time to move to another stage in addition to what's going on, and that is to encircle the offices of the members of Congress back in the districts all over the country. And then you will start seeing a little bit of sweating on Capitol Hill. I understand that there is a nonviolent civil disobedience sit-in today in Senator Mitch McConnell's office. Mitch McConnell is a warmonger. Mitch McConnell, if he searched 365 days a year, wouldn't have any empathy or sensitivity to what a lot of poor and ill and repressed people are going through in this country. He's not even like Ronald Reagan, whom I once described as a cruel man with a smile. Mitch McConnell doesn't even have a smile. And on the other side, there's John Boehner. John Boehner has a deep voice. That's what's gotten him. Nice, mellifluous voice. But if he had logos of corporations on his jacket, there wouldn't be enough room on the jacket. There'd be Sally Mae here, Exxon Mobil there, Pfizer here. He'd have to devote part of his forehead and his cheeks to the logos. 535 put their shoes on every day. They want something you can withhold or give them. That's your vote. So the more people do their homework, the more they demand more choices on the ballot, the more they push to get campaign money out of public elections. Public elections should be funded by public money, period. It can be done. The biggest bargain in history. It'll be the biggest bargain in history. These guys are buying the U.S. government for $5 billion every 4 years. Biggest bargain in history. To show you what $5 billion is, $5 billion is less than what we spend as a nation on dog food, not counting gourmet dog food. So bring it down to scale. Bring it down to scale. Let me just give you just a few quick points on what I think the Occupy movement is, how it's developing. One, they're very smart in expanding their numbers and their locales. They got a big mission. We got a big mission with them, and they better be ready when they go to specifics. They shouldn't get the specifics, as I said. But eventually, they're going to have to do two things. They're going to have to develop community economies, like democratic credit unions, democratic energy production, wind power. They're going to have to develop food, more farmer-to-food markets. They're going to have to develop more community health clinics. Those are the ways to replace Exxon, Bank of America, Aetna, and the agribusiness giants. Now, that can be done without any government permission other than local permits. But a lot of what we want has got to go through government. It's got to go through Congress first, like full Medicare for all. Eventually, that may be deconcentrated in another form. But we cannot wait and watch 800 people die every week and thousands more who are injured and sick because they can't afford insurance to get diagnosed and treated. This is what's known as corporate omnicide. They're the ones who are standing in the way of universal health insurance. It was proposed by Harry Truman back 65 years ago, and we still don't have it. In fact, we now are near 50 million people, men, women, and children, without health insurance, and another 50 grossly underinsured. The second thing is that the Occupy people are learning the techniques of nonviolent open disobedience, civil disobedience. That's very, very important. That is the most powerful, that is the most powerful way to get the power structure to start thinking about what's going to happen to them when there's no one left to guard the guards. No one left to guard the guards. The moral power of open, nonviolent civil disobedience. And that takes some training, you know, just mechanical training, but it also takes a civic personality. The civic personality is what they're forming. They may not know it, but they're becoming different people in these encampments all over the country. They're discovering talents they never thought they had. They're discovering skills they never thought their friends had. They're discovering stamina that they never thought under pressure like in Oakland and Denver and Atlanta that they ever thought had. They come back stronger the more they are dispossessed and dismantled. And so they are becoming different people. They are becoming people where they are looking at themselves as having a higher estimate of their own significance in what they're doing in life and what they're passing on to future generations. And I love the idea that there are bookshelves and libraries in these encampments, because part of it is having ever more effective conversations with one another without the interference of text messaging, straight out, eyeball to eyeball. Part of it is teaching one another. Some people may know a lot more about U.S. history, and other people may know a lot about communities and what's going on. And other people may not know about communities, and they may know not about American history, but they're fantastic motivators in emergencies. Suddenly they pop up, and they're fantastic in emergencies. And you never thought they would be great in emergencies. So that's very important. They're also developing the kind of intergenerational perspective. You can see people from all ages, which is very good, all ages, all backgrounds, and increasingly you'll see people who will be looking out for what is really the great motivator, which is posterity, their descendants, their children, and their grandchildren. And remember, children and grandchildren are going to inherit what our generation does or does not do. They're going to inherit the cost of the Iraq and Afghanistan criminal wars of aggression. They're going to inherit that bill because Congress didn't fund it. It's the first time in our history we didn't fund our wars. We just let the kids pay for it. Let the kids' kids pay for it. How are they going to look back on us? How are they going to look back? What are they going to think of us when we allow nuclear plants all over the country producing radioactive waste that's deadly for 200,000 years? When we could have the wind and the sun? What do you think the sun would do if it wrote a letter to the earth, its offspring? It would be embarrassing to read it. Shame on us. We have time to recover the integrity of our generation from its misdeeds. And that time will come from what we do and what we don't do. Because the children and grandchildren are going to inherit the results of what we do and what we don't do. And I found over the years, there are three sources of motivation for civic action. One is looking back at our forebears and look at what they did. Without electricity, without motor vehicles, without telephones, the fight against slavery, the fight for women's right to vote, the fight for the farmer, worker, progressive movements. This is what gave us all these things, the 40-hour week, the right to collective bargaining, freedom from slavery, the right to vote, progressive income tax, the weekend, so to speak. It gave us Social Security, gave us Medicare. When you see the heroics of these people and what they did with nothing but their heart, mind, and feet, they didn't have the communication, transportation that we had. You've got to be motivated by them. You got to say, hey, you know, look what they went through. The second motivation is just looking at the scene today. It's pretty horrible. You turn the TV on, they sugarcoat what's going on in this country with sleazy entertainment and advertisements, and you know, they report the winners. You got one out of every three workers in this country working for Walmart wages. $8, $9, $10 an hour without deductions, hardly any health insurance, no. You've got 50 million people, as I said, without health insurance. You've got 58,000 Americans who die every year from workplace-related diseases, OSHA figures. That's over 1,000 a week. Who weeps for them? Who reports on them? Who uses the bugle to remember them? They died for their corporations. 400,000 coal miners since 1890 have died for these coal companies. That's more than all the Americans who've died in World War II. 65,000 people die from air pollution. Horrible deaths, asphyxiation, EPA figures. 100,000 people die from malpractice in hospitals, negligence. Another 100,000 die from hospital-induced infections. The first comes from the Harvard School of Public Health. The second figure comes from the Centers for Disease Control. Isn't it amazing that all these forms of preventable violence are not given one-tenth of the attention and one-hundredth of the attention to the exaggeration of that criminal gang that struck on 9/11? Because the 9/11 strike produces a lot of business for the military-industrial complex. That massacre produces a lot of business. There's not much business, is there, in preventing 300,000 American lives who die from workplace-related hazards, who die from negligence, who die from product defects, who die from bacteria and virals that are preventable. See how much we have to refocus the attention of people who don't get this kind of information. Now, it just happened, I was working on this little book, it's coming out in about a month. I can't believe how it connects with the Occupy movement. It's called Getting Steamed to Overcome Corporatism. We got to use that word more often, corporatism. Build it together to win. And here's the way I wrote this book. This book is written to get people to have fire in their belly. It's 200 examples from 2009, taken from the major press, of outrageous corporate crime, abuses, and frauds affecting health, safety, economic well-being, the simple freedoms that we have that we're deprived of. And the idea is to go through them and read it and then see if this experiment gets you to do something different from your daily routine, gets you to break out of your daily routine civically and politically to start mobilizing with other people. And so this is what I mean by the combination of principles of fairness and fair play with the facts that we have before us. I just want to end on one note here. Albert Einstein is known for the following quote: problems cannot be solved at the same level of awareness that created them. What the Occupy movement is doing is raising the nation's awareness to the level of the problems that they have to confront. And remember, it was over 2,000 years ago that Marcus Cicero, the great Roman orator, lawyer, defined freedom better than any definition I've heard since. See if you agree. He said, freedom is participation in power. By that definition, how much freedom do we have?
Take it in there.
Okay? So that's what it really comes down to. So thank you for coming. We'll have a discussion. And remember, this is your commons. Thank you.